Edward Theodore Gein was born on the 27th of August 1906 at La Crosse County, Wisconsin in the USA to George Philip and Augusta Wilhelmine Gein. He shared his mother with an older brother named Henry George Gein. Augusta was an ardent follower of Lutheranism and imparted knowledge to her sons on topics like the innate immortality of the world, the sins of carnal desire and drinking, etc. What Ed's father, George Philip Gein, a seasoned alcoholic, thought of his wife's sermons, we can only imagine. Mrs. Gein didn't encourage visitors, so the brothers only had each other as companions, although they were allowed to attend school, but after lessons were over, the brothers were forbidden to socialize with the other children. They had to return straight home and help their mother with chores around the homestead. Ed did actually quite well in his lessons, particularly in reading, but his painful shyness held him back from being socially accepted by his peers. And his strange habit of laughing out loud for no apparent reason further hindered any bonding with his classmates. In the early years of the marriage, while the boys were still young, Ed's father tried his hand at many different trades, but because of his heavy drinking, he found it hard to keep a job. He had worked at various times as a carpenter, tanner, and unconvincing insurance salesman. They even opened up a grocery shop, but only after a few years had to sell the struggling business. So they decided to pack all their belongings on a rickety truck and drive to a new start. Destination: Plainfield, Wisconsin. Augusta hoped the new start would sober George up, and while in the beginning he did display a new energy to prosper, he soon fell back off the wagon and became morose and despondent with his family. In 1940, at the age of 66, George finally succumbed to the drink and his wife's nagging. Augusta was now determined that her two boys would not follow in their father's footsteps. Her sermons on the evils of drink and wanton hussies became even more intense. She needed her sons to run the farm they had settled on before George's demise. She would not tolerate them fooling around with women who would lead them astray. Ed and Henry built themselves a good reputation around town. They didn't drink, they worked hard, were honest, and were employed by the members of the community as handymen when any manual labor was needed. Ed was much in demand as babysitter for farmers and their wives who wanted a respite from their daily grind to head into town on a Friday night. Henry, meantime, had started dating a divorced woman with two kids and was planning to move in with her. Augusta was horrified at the prospect. Henry started bad-mouthing their mother to Ed. This was not a good idea. On May the 16th, 1944, Henry and Ed were burning away old vegetation on their property. As sometimes happens, the fire got out of control. Ed called the local fire brigade, who managed after several hours to extinguish it. Sometime afterwards, Ed rang the sheriff's office to report Henry missing. A search party was organized. It was already dusk, but after scouring the farm by torchlight, they finally located Henry's lifeless body. Curiously, it wasn't burned, so the local doctor listed the death as apparent heart failure. Some later reports suggest there were also bruises to his head. It was now just Ed and Augusta. They drew closer to each other in their isolation. Shortly after Henry's death, she suffered a stroke, and Ed waited on her hand and foot. He never wanted to disappoint his mother, to see that look in her eyes she'd given Henry because of his gallivanting ways. He would always be a devoted and chaste son, but still, he had urges, and alone at night in bed, he would fantasize about the females he couldn't touch. He was very shy around women anyway, couldn't talk to them, but he longed to caress them, to feel their soft skin on his. Only 19 months after Henry's burial, Augusta suffered a second and final stroke, dying on December the 29th, 1945, at the age of 67. Ed was absolutely devastated. His mother was his universe. Now, utterly alone on the farm, Ed became strange in his ways. Neighbors reported seeing lights on in Augusta's room, and they said the property was becoming run down. Still, Ed was managing to survive with the usual odd jobs around town. When times got really tough, he sold an 80-acre parcel of land that Henry had purchased years before. Throughout the 50s, Ed started to buy magazines that focused on death and mutilation, particularly those describing and showing images of cannibalism and Nazi atrocities. He also pored over books on human anatomy. Pornographic literature also fueled the fires of his deviant lust. Unable to contain his desires any longer, Ed jumped into his car one night and headed off to where he knew he could find some women who would gratify his urgent needs. He drove past the bar in town and to the outskirts where Plainfield Cemetery lay deserted and silent. He had heard of a recent burial of a local lady. Ed had always admired her from afar, never had the courage to start any small talk with her. Now he felt confident, here in the dark, only him and his lover who awaited beneath the soil. He had worked up a sweat shoveling away the dirt from the coffin, but his farm-toiled body was used to physical exercise. Still, he must conserve his energies for the fleshy delights which awaited him once he returned home with his prize. Soon the shovel hit wood. Scraping away the remaining earth from the lid, Ed prized it open to reveal a corpse that had been interred for several days. the gases that had built up found freedom in the night air. After making sure to fill the grave in again to avoid detection, Ed propped the body in the back of his car and took it back to the farm. After reversing into the barn, he feverishly removed the clothes from the corpse and hoisted it onto a meat hook. Ed denied having actual sex with the bodies, saying they smelled too bad. Once secured, he then disemboweled and removed trophies from the body. He would carefully slice off pieces that titillated him. These he would cure to preserve them. His favorite part was the vagina, which he'd wear next to his own genitalia while donning a pair of women's underwear. This gave him immense satisfaction. Ed confessed later to robbing 9 graves. From these bodies he made a variety of items, some personal decoration, some household items, and many mementos of the cut-up cadavers. Now he decided to look beyond Plainfield Cemetery to find females who weren't rotting. His first victim was barkeeper Mary Hogan, whom Ed shot with a .32 caliber Mauser pistol. On November the 17th, 1957, during an investigation at Gein's property, her head was found in a box, although he was not officially tried for her murder. According to the judge on Gein's case, the reason for not prosecuting him was because of prohibitive costs. His second and apparent final victim was hardware store owner Bernice Warden, 58. The day before Gein murdered Warden, he visited her shop and promised to return the next day to buy another item. The last receipt found before Bernice Warden's disappearance documented a purchase made by an Eddie Gein. When Frank Warden returned to his mother's hardware store, he discovered a small pool of blood and a trail leading out of the store's back door. Her son then advised the police to search Ed's property. They had no idea what they were about to stumble upon. The local children were all convinced Ed's house was haunted. And the sheriff and his deputy chuckled to themselves on the drive out there, wondering if there was any truth to the tales. As they parked the car and got out, there was a deathly silence, not even bird song. They approached the barn first, swung open the door, and were greeted by the sight of the naked and headless body of Bernice Warden, hanging upside down from a meat hook and slit open down the front. Her head and intestines were later discovered in a box, and her heart was on a plate in the dining room. The property appeared deserted, so with torches they entered the main house. As they peered through the windows, they could see the kitchen area, which was filled with junk and in total disarray. After forcing entry, they discovered outrages that all their years on the force had not prepared them for. Art Schley, one of the officers, died before Gein's trial came to court. He was only 43. Friends and family said he was utterly traumatized by what he had discovered inside Ed's house. The whole downstairs area was a complete rubbish tip. Ed had just let it go to ruin after his mother's death. But the upper floors had been closed off, and his mother's room had been kept exactly how it was before she had died. As the officers began searching through the debris, horrors emerged before their eyes. The flayed skins from 10 human heads were found preserved, and another skin taken from the upper torso of a woman was casually rolled up on the floor. There was also a belt adorned with carved-off nipples, a chair upholstered in human skin, the crown of a skull used as a soup bowl, lampshades covered in seamed and tanned human skin, a table propped up by a human shin bone, and a refrigerator full of human organs. The four posts on Gein's bed were topped with skulls, and a shrunken head hung on the wall alongside 9 death masks, the skinned faces of women that Gein longed to be. The sickened officers also uncovered a shoebox full of dried-out female genitalia, faces stuffed with newspapers and mounted like hunting trophies on the walls, and a female skin suit patched together from the skins of various grave-robbing expeditions. It appears that Ed had always had an intense longing to become a woman, something he could never ever admit to his mother. After her death, his obsession propelled him to live out this overwhelming desire. Of course, Ed Gein also had other very disturbing personality issues, the end result being what the unsuspecting officers found when they pushed open the creaky door into Ed's horrific theater of death. On the evening of the same day, Gein was arrested at a West Plainfield grocery store. Upon questioning, he admitted to making almost 40 nocturnal visits to the local graveyard in order to dig up graves of recently buried females of various ages, in order to take home and make macabre objects from them. During the interrogation, he admitted to killing Mary Hogan, the tavern owner, who had gone missing since 1954, but later he denied any memory of the incident. Ed Gein was found medically unfit to undergo trial and subsequently was sent to Central State Hospital in Waupun, Wisconsin. He was later transferred to Mendota State Hospital in Madison, Wisconsin. In 1968, he was declared fit by doctors to stand trial, and was found not guilty by Judge Robert H. Golmar on the basis of mental insanity. He spent the rest of his life locked away. Ed Gein died of lung cancer on the 26th of July 1984 at the Mendota Mental Health Institute. It was said he was always a model prisoner, gentle, polite, and discreet. He died of respiratory problems and heart failure. He was buried at the Plainfield Cemetery. Over the years, many visitors vandalized the gravestone by chipping off pieces to have as souvenirs, and in 2000, the main part of the gravestone was stolen. It was recovered the following year and is currently maintained in a museum in Wasara County. While Gein was in detention, his house burned to the ground. Arson was suspected. In 1958, Gein's car, which he had used to transport the bodies of his victims, was sold at public auction for the then considerable sum of $760 to an enterprising carny sideshow operator named Bunny Gibbons. Gibbons called his attraction the Ed Gein Ghoul Car, and charged carnival goers 25 cent admission to see it. The whereabouts of the car is unknown today. Now a list of what was found by the officers in Ed Gein's house. Whole human bones and fragments, a wastebasket made of human skin covering several chair seats, skulls on his bedposts, female skulls, some with the top sawn off, bowls made from human skulls, a corset made from a female torso skinned from the shoulders to the waist, leggings made from human leg skin, masks made from the skin of female heads, Mary Hogan's face mask in a paper bag, Mary Hogan's skull in a box, Bernice Warden's entire head in a burlap sack, Bernice Warden's heart on a plate in front of Gein's stove, 9 vulvae in a shoebox, a young girl's dress, and the vulvas of 2 females judged to have been about 15 years old. A belt made from female human nipples, 4 noses, a pair of lips on a window shade drawstring, a lampshade made from the skin of a human face, and fingernails from female fingers. Well, my friends, I hope you enjoyed my latest historical feature. And welcome to Oddie's Chill Out Lounge after all those descriptions of cut-off nipples and dried-out vulvae. What is it that attracts us to horror films and horror in general? What fascinates us about that? You know, Hollywood knows that sex and horror sells, and we know why sex sells, but why does horror sell so good? Why is it such a fascinating subject that sometimes we dare not look at the screen and we're watching a horror movie at the cinema, but at the same time we force ourselves to look. We're fascinated with the dark side of humanity. Whether it's a good thing, whether we can learn from it, it's not for me to judge. But it has a huge audience. And on that subject, YouTube, as you may or may not know, some people do know, they have recently made a new policy regarding certain content that is allowed on YouTube, or not so much allowed, that too, but what they are cracking down on regarding ad revenue. Apparently certain advertisers don't want their subject associated with certain content. And I understand that, you know, that's obviously it's their money. And so it's their right to do what they think right with their advertising money. And yeah, because of that, I can't show all the images all of the items that they found in Ed Gein's house, because I would lose my revenue on that, or the possibility of losing it. And yeah, I don't want to do that because I'm bringing you these videos for free. And I really need something. They're a lot of work. So, you know, the revenue is a good thing. It's a good thing. It doesn't pay for all my time, but it's not bad. It keeps me going. So, yeah, this is the YouTube version that you've just watched. But I have made a version, the uncensored version. And if you want to see that, when I include all the images that are not allowed here on YouTube, then you can find that on my Patreon link, which I will include at the end screen here and also under the description. So for as little as $1, you could become my patron. And not only will I really appreciate that, but it opens up historical features, mini historical features that are not on YouTube and won't be on YouTube. I'm doing this as a reward for my patrons. They do deserve something extra for their support of my channel, and I'm glad to do it. Also, this uncensored version, I don't know how much I'm going to charge for that. It's only going to be a couple of bucks. It won't be much. So if you want to support me and watch the uncensored version of this video, then yeah, please head over there. Be very grateful. Obviously, times are changing on YouTube, and yeah, I can't bring you all the things that I'd like to. And I know a lot of you out there don't really want to see all that gore and you know, cut up bodies and stuff. The descriptions of it are enough, but for those of you who do, and I know you guys are out there too, well, there it is. The uncensored version is over at Patreon. By the way, what you're watching on the screen now is not the uncensored version. It's one of my mini historical features, of which I hope to be doing many just for my Patreon patrons. I will also be doing the main historical features here on YouTube, guys. So don't worry, I'm not going to forget about you. But yeah, I'm not going to, you know, there won't be any less historical features on YouTube. I just want to offer that extra reward for the financial support that my Patreon supporters give me. Before I go, I'd like to give a shout out to Erin Curtis. She's a friend of mine on Facebook. She also is one of my followers here on YouTube, and she's a supporter on Patreon. And Erin is at the Providence Medical Center in Oregon. She's unfortunately suffering from liver cancer. So please, guys, send all your love and light to her. And she had some friends on the ward, or she has some friends, Gina and Natalie. And this was going to be a shout out to both of them. Unfortunately, Erin informed me that yesterday Gina passed away. And Gina was suffering from breast cancer, as is Natalie. And so that's very sad news. And my deepest condolences to Gina's family. And please, Erin and Natalie, hang in there. Oddie's rooting for you. So, and a big shout out to Nurse Leia. She's looking after my girls there at the Providence Medical Center in Oregon, and all the staff. I know you're doing a great job. So yeah, that's my big shout out to you guys. So yeah, send them love and light, my dear Oddites. Yeah, and I will see you next time. My next video is going to be probably a giveaway, and then there's going to be two more re-edits of old silent historical features, which will be followed by a brand new historical feature. So thank you for watching. It's been a pleasure. I hope it has been for you. I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.